everyone. Let's get started. I'm Viktor Denchenko, and I'm working for Yandex for more than 3 years, and today I would like to talk about asynchrony and coroutines. I guess it's a very interesting topic because it likes the compiler and execution checking. You can implement unusual stuff that cannot be implemented using common approaches. Here is a list of topics that I would like to discuss. First of all, I would like to discuss different approaches related to simple cell social analysis. We are going to discuss different advantages and drawbacks of different approaches, and from the way to address about how it should be. Secondly, I will introduce the coroutines. I'm sure that how they can be used together with asynchronous programming. I will consider interaction scheduler. They will actually increase the visibility and specification of your code. Multi-threaded applications usually use shared data to access different threads and to cooperate between threads, and we consider the conversion aspects and none of those solutions. And finally, I'll summarize my presentation. Okay, let's consider a simple server. And the task is to utilize as much GPU as we have, and we would like to accept baseline connections and handle them. The first of the solution is to create on each client to create a new thread. And here you can use the code that represents that idea. First one is to accept, is to create acceptor that allows us to accept new connections. Then in infinite loop, accept client open requests and start new thread. For example, here I use to thread for that purpose. And I'll send socket to manipulate the data. And then I read my data from the socket, obtain a request, and then I handle that request, obtain a response, and then I write that response into the socket and client receive the data. It looks very simple, but it contains significant drawback, because here you can see three working calls, on accept, on read, and when I write the data, right? And I would like to remove working calls because it's a waste of CPU resources. Instead of doing useful work, most time I'm waiting for IO events, and I'm glad to avoid that. But I would like to do it in another way. I would like to use asynchronous server. And the idea here is to execute the callback that is going to be executed on a completion. When operation completes, the callback is executed and I can continue my operations. Here you can see the code that represents that idea. First of all, I create acceptor as before, and then I work on accept method to accept new connection. And inside callback, it's going to be invoked on completion. I do unread operation. And inside unread, I obtain request, handled, and obtain a response, and then I work on write to finalize my handling. This code contains three asynchronous calls. They don't block my execution, and it's more careful resource utilization, but you know, it's look not so simple as it was before, because it's complicated because I need to wrap my computer applications using the callbacks, and it's like a diagonal programming because each asynchronous call allows you to use a lambda, and each lambda adds more and more spaces into your code. But actually, it's not a real code, it's a simplified version because that code doesn't contain appropriate error handling, it doesn't contain a loop, the real code looks like the following. You don't need to look through that code, it's just to illustrate the complexity of the real server, and you can compare the simplified version. So, it looks pretty complex, and so I would like to reduce the complexity. Okay, let's discuss the advantages and disadvantages of the asynchronous server. First of all, we have a better performance because currently we don't block our threads. We are performing our necessary stuff and we carefully utilize our CPU resources. And because callbacks can be moved at any thread, it provides automatic concurrency and parallel execution. But the only nasty drawback is it's a complexity, and the sources of the complexity is the following. First of all, the code complexity is growing faster than the original complexity of the task in a non-linear way. And secondly, you need to have an explicit context manipulation, right? And you have also strange and a little bit complicated error handling because at any time you have to do this error because code can return errors at any time and you need to do appropriate cleanup procedure. And it relates to another complexity related to object life. time. The common approach is to use a reference count approach, like using a shared PR or another shared from this, and you have to use it explicitly on any call, on any callback. Another aspect is to debugging, because, for example, you have a stack trace, but you don't understand the history from a stack trace, because you have just an invocation of your callback, and you have to extract necessary data based on a context, and sometimes it's very tricky and complicated thing. Thus, the asynchronous approach tends to be error-prone. It might break your production and allow you to unpredicted and unexpected asynchronous path in your overcomplicated logic. And what would I like to have? I would like to combine both synchronous and asynchronous approaches and eliminate the drawbacks, specifically to take effectiveness from asynchronous approach and to take simplicity from asynchronous one. And how can this be achieved? And the answer is use coroutines. Let me briefly introduce the coroutines. So everyone, I guess, knows that what it means. It's just ordinary function or method, and it means that on return you have completed all routine actions. Now coroutine means a partial action completion and rotation, right? Routine is a special case of coroutine because coroutine can be suspended at any time, and you can then resume. And those points, you can have several points of suspension. And here is a short list of well-known coroutine examples. Python generates coroutines, and I think a lot of C++ protocol also contains the coroutines. Actually, there are three protocols, related coroutines, there are stackful and stackless protocols. I'm going to talk about stackful coroutines. It's a method of saving of context execution, and it provides more powerful and it's powerful flexibility for code. But we have a problem because coroutines are not part of the language still, and we need to use low-level manipulations to save our context, to switch to another context, and it depends on the platform, on the compiler, and on architecture. Fortunately, we have a solution. It's a boost context library, and it's very effective because it contains a very simple assembly instructions. It provides a wide range of platforms and architectures, and from the user perspective, it looks like a cross-platform library, and you don't need to use heavyweight constructions like last fibers and such that stuff. Just use a boost context because it's a very low level and very effective library. Okay, let's briefly discuss. The content of boost context, it consists of two functions, make f context that creates our context, and then f context that allows us to switch to another context. In particular, usage is the following. The first step, we need to allocate stack memory. Then, I need to create a context by invoking make f context function. Here, I specify stack parameters and coroutine callback to be executed. It can be any callback that I want. Then I would like to start or resume my coroutine. For that purpose, I invoke jump as context, right? And here I specify the coroutine context to be saved here and our created coroutine context and the pointer to transfer data to the coroutine. And to return the suspend from coroutine, I invoke jump as context, but with select context parameters. You see, looks pretty the same. And now, using this technique, let's consider the implementation of coroutine. Here I have a coroutine. It's a function. It's an ordinary function. It doesn't contain any specific types, like futures, whatever. It doesn't contain special keywords. It's just an ordinary function. And inside the function, at any time, I can invoke yield to suspend my execution. And here you can see usage. First of all, I create an instance of my coroutine by using core class, and I immediately start that coroutine. Then coroutine is suspended and I resume it later, and log output represents the sequence of operations. You can see that I start and suspend and that stuff. And now I have a coroutine and I would like to transfer my code and convert my asynchronous invocation into synchronous invocation. And you can see the synchronous invocation is a real synchronous one, and we don't need to specify code back here. And we can use the following implementation. In the first step, I obtain the reference to the current coroutine, and then I invoke my asynchronous function, and in callback, I just resume my coroutine. And the only thing I need is to invoke yield to suspend my coroutine. So when asynchronous operation completes, my coroutine from the callback will be removed automatically. Let's consider the sequence diagram and the sequence of operations. Here I have thread, that it can be like split thread, whatever you want, and here in the core implementation based on this context library, and I would like to implement a sync write function, and network allows me to handle that operation in a synchronous way. In the first step, I start my coroutine, and then I invoke my asynchronous operation, and then I suspend my coroutine invoking yield function. then I wait for completion. And when I think the right is completed, I work in the room and continue my execution. So I start to perform, and this procedure doesn't work that well because between yield and completion, you can handle actions with other coaches or other planets, right? And it looks like a synchronous location, but actually it's not. But here is the problem, this condition, because in a multi-threaded environment, we have not the only thread, but we have